Ryan, it's Ricky from Black Star Riders.
Hey, man, what's up?
I'm good. How are you?
Good, good. Before we get started, I just wanted to thank you. My site, Rock Eyes, started in 2004, and in 2005, we interviewed you, and really, you helped us along the way, and you know, I just wanted to thank you for...
Oh, really? Oh, thanks, man.
Yeah, for coming on.
Well, I saw the name on the, you know, the interview sheet, and I remembered the... I remember that site, you know?
Right, yeah. We reviewed your a solo CD of yours and
yeah,
stuff like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, it really helps when you have, like, you know, a person like you giving us a start, actually, because, we, like I said, we started in 2004. You know, it's over 10 years now. And,
that's great.
And
that's great.
You helped us, you know?
Oh, well, no, thank you, man. I mean, I did nothing, you know, but that's great. I appreciate it, and that's fantastic. You guys are still going strong 10 years later. In this world, you know, that's, you know yourself, that's an achievement right there.
Definitely, definitely. So, Black Star Riders, February 20th.
Yeah.
Killer Instincts. How's it feel having a second CD under your belt?
You know, it's great. I mean, I'm a big believer. People vote with their feet, and you know, if people hadn't embraced the band, I wouldn't be talking to you. We wouldn't have made that second album. It just wouldn't have happened. You know, we need the people out there to come to the shows and buy the products to give us the chance to do what we do. And that, thankfully, that happened. They were very supportive. They embraced the name change. And they embraced the first album. And it's enabled the band to grow. It's enabled us to tour and become a better band for it. And I think we've made a better album for it as well.
Cool, cool. I mean, you're really getting a lot of exposure for this, you know, the new CD and stuff like that. And, I mean, the name's out there now. And
sure.
You know, it's recognized. And, you know, I think it's a big... You know, maybe not a big change from, you know, the first CD, All Hell's Breaking Loose, but I mean, every place you look, like, the press is there for you guys, and it's amazing, you know?
Yeah, you know, we've got a great work ethic in the band, and we work hard at it, you know, much as we're old school guys, and we love, you know, the way it was in days of yore with the vinyl and all that, which we still do through Nuclear Blast. You know, myself and Damon are very... active on the internet, and we try and keep in touch with everybody and promote the band as much as we can. And you know, it's what you make it. It's if you know you've got something you believe in, you got to get out there and you got to sell it. You got to make people you know, want to come and see your band and want to listen to your song. And you know, that takes work.
Cool, cool. You know, I want to go back just 1 year to your two solo albums, Using Pledge Music.
Sure.
What was your feeling like, you know, using Pledge Music and asking for donations or whatever you want to call it?
Yeah.
I mean, you put out one acoustic and one rock album. Yesterday I watched, you know, your promo clip on YouTube about, you know, Pledge Music. Tell me the feeling about using that product.
Well, just simply, you know, it was an ambitious project that I wanted to do. I wanted to record two albums, and, you know, making albums is not cheap. I just knew that I wouldn't have got anywhere near the level of support financially or probably in any other front from a record label to want to do that. So I went direct to the people out there that have supported me over the years. I said, look, you know, you want to be part of this. All we're doing is you guys are buying. It's just the same as if you buy the album when it comes out on iTunes or in your local record store if you've still got one. Right. There's no difference. All you're doing is buying it up front.
Right. Wow.
And you're trusting me to make a great record. All you're doing, and we're eliminating the middleman. We're taking out the record company. So we're taking out the bullshit, the guys that take the big cut. You know, the guys that say, no, you can't do that or you can't have that package. You know, you can't. Those guys don't exist. It's me and the people that are out there. And we made it together, you know, every step of the way. Every week I do an update, I give away exclusive stuff, I do a live track, I play, you know, live. It became known as the Stairwell Sessions. I play a song every week from the stair, sitting on the stairs in my house. And they'd be involved every step of the way. I'd ask them what they thought as it went along, what, you know, what ideas they wanted to incorporate in there. So they were, it's their album as much as mine. And, you know, they were getting 20 songs. The initial download was 20 songs for $10.
Right.
I mean, you can't even get that on iTunes. You know?
Yeah.
And it's just a way to go for somebody that's lucky enough for myself to have, you know, a very, very loyal and passionate following who have been very supportive. It just means I can deal directly with them and they can deal directly with me. They can tell me what they don't like. They can tell me what they do like. What we're doing is kind of record company. People go, oh, you know, it's big. And it's really, oh, you know, I'm sorry, but record company's been ripping off artists for fucking, you know, for the last 45, 50 years.
Right.
You know, and this is, you know, this with the way the industry's changing, this is taking that out of the equation. All you're doing is asking people to buy the album
right
ahead of time, you know, that we're going to buy it anyway.
Wow.
Yeah. You know,
very good, very good. You know, I was listening to another, you know, little interview with Damon this morning and stuff like that,
and
they were telling, you know, us fans, you know, they could come in with any kind of music and stuff, and you're such a great lyricist. you know, what does it feel like being in a band that, like, they're almost like looking up to you or giving you a product, and they said you can make a story out of just about anything. You know,
it's so awesome that those guys are saying that stuff, and obviously it's a real honor that's, you know, how highly they regard me. I'm blown away by it, you know. I mean, Scott Gorham, when he offered me the Lizzy gig, I knew Scott, but his belief and confidence in me has never wavered. And it's huge to have somebody of Scott Gorham's, you know, caliber
right
basically going, I know you got this, and I'm putting my faith and my trust in you. It is such an honor to have that bestowed upon you. And Damon, too. You know, Damon's a great songwriter in his own right and has been over the years. And, you know, I knew that the day that I got the Lizzy gig, it was a life-changing opportunity. And I knew that, you know, my dream had come true and as of joining a band that I'd worshipped as a kid. And it was just, I was like, I'm not going to screw this up. I'm just going to, you know, this needs my full attention. I've been given a great chance here to show people what I can do, and you know, I guess I upped the ante even more than right. than you know, myself. And I've not fallen into that trap, which I was guilty of before, like a lot of musicians, where I will sometimes say I'll write when I need to make a record,
right?
And I write all the time. Mm-hmm. So at any one point, some, you know, those guys can say, hey, I got this. I go, right, well, I got a couple of sheets of lyrics here that I've been working on for the last month. I think one of these might fit this. So I'm never presented with a riff and I say, well, I'll get back to you and I have to go away and, you know, struggle to come up with something, and, you know, 3 months pass. And, you know, I just think that's kind of productive. And I've learned, it's something I've learned as I've got older, that you need to be on it all the time.
Right.
Well, I think you do anyway. So, you know, I'm inspired by that. I'm in a band with, you know, phenomenal musicians, and they make my life very easy.
Right.
They really do, because they're such great players. Wow. And, you know, I guess it works both ways. I find it really easy to come up with stuff knowing that those guys are always going to deliver on the playing front and, you know, on that end of it. So it's, you know, I guess it's just good all around.
Wow. When a fan comes up to you and says, you know, I heard some of the tunes and stuff like that, and you really give the impression of sounding like Phil, what goes through your mind saying, you know, people are, you know, I don't think they're comparing. I think they're just saying you sound like him. Even on this new album, it's amazing.
Yeah.
Like, you know, what's that feeling like?
And well, you know, here's the truth of it. I mean, you know, I'll usually give them a shorter answer, but I'll give you the longer one. You know, when I got the Thin Lizzy gig, there was obviously, you know, how am I going to do this? And I obviously wanted to be completely respectful and honorable to the legacy of Phil and the legacy of Thin Lizzy. But I, as a fan, I would want to go and see Thin Lizzy, and whatever guy is singing for him, I want those songs to sound like Phil singing them.
Right.
Or as close as it's going to get without the great man being there. So that's what I said about doing when Scott offered me the gig. I was like, right, I'm going to learn this stuff inside out. And, you know, I studied Lizzy even more. I studied Phil. I read his poetry books. I read interviews with him. I watched more YouTube footage of the man performing. Not that I wanted to anyway rip off what he does live. That would be crass. He's unique. I just wanted to try and understand the man.
Right.
And what was going through his mind, and what he was thinking when he wrote those lyrics to, say, Jailbreak or Dancing in the Moonlight, or the passion that he delivered those lyrics with. I wanted to make sure that I had that passion and intensity and deliverance when I stood up there and sang the man's songs.
Right.
That's what I wanted to make sure. And I've been submerged in that whole thing now totally for the last 4 years. So it's ingrained in me. It's right. Part of me now. It's part of my DNA now. That's just what I do. I don't even think about it. So it's rubbed off on me. I've almost been schooled by Phil. I've been taught by Phil, even though he's no longer with us. I've still learned a lot of it. And it's changed me. I'm a much better lyricist. I'm a much better singer. And I'm a much better performer than I was 4 years ago. And that's thanks to Phil. And people go, oh, how can you say that? He's dead. I said, no, but he's not. His music isn't. He's left us his wonderful legacy, and you can still absorb it and learn from it, and that's just what I've done. So it's just part of who I am now.
Cool. Very cool. You know, it's respectful, and you're doing a great job. You know,
thank you very much.
You know, listening to the new CD and stuff like that, three tracks really stick out in my mind, and they're all together. They just happen to be all together on the CD. The first one is Soldier Town, which I had that Gaelic sound and stuff like that, and I really enjoyed that song. And the following two tracks I also love were I Gotta Go and Blindsided. All three of them songs are just simply amazing.
Thank you.
You know, I mean, I love the whole CD, but them three right in a row just like really punched me, you know, and great stuff like that. Tell me about the future of the band now. Are you going to be touring or what's going to happen?
Yeah, you know, we're going to hit the road and do what we do best, get out there and play live and promote the hell out of this album. You know, we start over in the UK, we actually go on a co-headline bill with the band Europe, which will be a lot of fun.
Right.
And then we're booking shows as we're talking. You know, shows are coming in, festivals. We're going to do some stateside work. You know, we want to just stay out as long as we can and promote the record.
Cool. Now, I was looking some research and stuff like that. Is it amazing to you that, like, the new album, our CD, whatever you want to call it, it's also going to come out on white vinyl and I think flesh vinyl and who knows what? You know,
it's
like
great,
it's a flashback, you know?
Yeah. Well, for guys our age, and you know, obviously, you know, there's a lot of Black Star Riders fans that are middle-aged at our age and you know, remember when buying a record was an event.
Right.
You know, you waited for that day for the album came out, you got the bus, the train, or you drove, you could drive into town, into the record store to meet up with other, you know, people that loved that band and physically went and bought that record and bring it home and reading the sleeve. I mean, it was just an event. It was huge. And, you know, I'm sorry. And I have children of my own who are teenagers and they're into music. But they're never going to know the joy of that. And you try and explain it to them, they're just like, well, it sounds like a lot of hard work, Dad. You know, because they click their finger on the computer and they've got the new album. And that's fine for them, but I can tell there's not the same, you don't get the same thing out of it, you know, they're not getting a full appreciation out of what it is and what it was, because, you know, why would they? You don't know any different.
Right.
And I really like the fact that Nuclear Blast is a label that embraces that technology that we have today, but also is very, very into, you know, vinyl, the CDs, the gatefold sleeves, all the great stuff that we all know and love, because there's plenty of people still out there that want that.
Right.
Absolutely there is. Right. So, I love it, you know?
Right. Do you feel bands have it? I know there's, you know, a huge amount of bands out there trying to make it, but do you feel, you know, like you're talking about CDs and stuff like that, do you think they have it a lot easier? Like, I mean, I get 200 letters, emails a day saying, can you review my CD? And all they're doing is pushing a button.
Yeah.
You know, like, it feels like, I know they're working on their material and stuff like that, but I mean, back then we had flyers on street poles, all this other kind of stuff, and now they can just sit back and enjoy.
Well, I think you had to work harder at it back then. You know, it took more of a physical effort to get out there and get people to hear about your music and your band, because there wasn't the internet, so, you know, you had to really be a lot more proactive. Like you said, now it's a lot easier, and I think, you know, that brings with it its own demons, as in quality controls has kind of gone out the window. Like, any fucking idiot can, you know, call themselves or, you know, a musician now, and without really putting in the work, because it's all there on a keyboard, you know, in front of them.
Right.
And I think that before, you know, the days of, you know, you learning the guitar and then, you know, getting your buddies over and going in the garage and rehearsing and working and building up a sweat and, you know, really believing in what you do, that's unfortunately, you know, a lot of kids don't experience that because they want to take the shortcut.
Right.
And then you take the shortcut, you're not going to have the quality. You just aren't. I'm sorry, but you're not, you know. And I think that it's, you know, it was hard back then, it's hard now, it'll be hard 20 years down the line, whatever way we get our music then. It's just the music industry's never been easy, you know. But I believe that, you know, a quality band and quality songs, and if you want it bad enough like anything else, you'll get there in the end.
Yeah, I mean, me doing my site Rock Eyes and stuff like that, it really, you know, looking back, you know, I back days in the 80s, 90s, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
I miss so much of that stuff compared to what it is today. You know, it's just not the same.
No, it's not, you know, and you know, without sounding like the old fogies that we are, you know, you can't explain that to a 15-year-old kid because they've never understood it and they never will.
Right.
But we did. We obviously see how it was then, and the best of both worlds. And it'll keep changing. But you know, life keeps changing, and the music industry is going to keep changing. And yeah, I'm firmly a believer of, you know, yeah, it was amazing back then, but it's still pretty cool right now. And you just got to adapt, or you die.
Right. Yeah.
You know?
Definitely. So, are you happy the way your career, ended up?
You know, no complaints. If somebody told me at the age of 19 that I'd still be doing this at 48 years old and be making a living and paying the bills and having a good life out of something that I love and something that I've always wanted to do, I wouldn't have believed it. You know, it's almost 30 years now of being a professional musician. So I have no complaints.
Right.
I kind of have, you know.
Right, but you really worked hard to get where you are.
I did, you know. I mean, I'm not a gifted musician. I'm not a gifted guitar player. I don't think I'm a gifted singer. I've had to work hard at both those things. But, you know, I'm a working class boy. I was brought up with that belief instilled in me that, you know, whatever you get in this life, you need to work hard for it. And, you know, I'm no stranger to hard work. And I think that, you know, that's something that you need to do if you want to try and succeed in this sort of crazy world that we live in, you know?
Right, definitely. Ricky Warwick, Black Star Riders, February 20th, the new CD, The Killer Instincts. Man, it was great talking to you. Really a flashback for me, and an honor.
No problem, bro. Good to talk again. Thanks very much, and congratulations on Rock Eyes, you know, being 10 years old. That's fantastic.
Thanks a lot. You want to say anything to the fans out there?
Yeah, absolutely. Listen, without you folks, it wouldn't happen. You make it happen. You're the reason we do what we do. Your support, your love, your devotion. Please don't go away anywhere. Please keep coming, keep buying the stuff, keep coming to the shows, and spread the word. And Blackstar Riders will be coming to see you real soon.
Thanks, Ricky, man. I really appreciate it.
Cheers, buddy. You take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.